Chapter 17. Fleck. Orphy crouched, making as little noise as possible. She saw a giant, tipped-over tear jar, also called a weeping vase, and the small green sprig poking out to see her. She had seen the jar before when it was used to collect mourners' tears that could then be buried with their loved ones. The tear jar was plastered together in pieces of books. There was a miniature chair of hard-bound pages, a table of encyclopedia pages, and a dresser of bookmarks. Her fascination grew. "Is this your home?" she asked. The small, twisted grass boy timidly cowered under his bed, made from a folded book cover. "My name is Orphy," she coaxed. "You don't have to be scared." Orphy noticed most of the room was a collection of torn-out pages of Principles of Good Taste, but commented instead on a small, hollow quill pen, which she mistook for a musical instrument. "Do you like to play that horn?" The boy remained silent under the bed and revealed the ripped-apart pieces of pages he stole. "I play the tuba," she continued. "It's like yours, but longer, serpent-shaped. It goes wah, 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 wah. I play it at home all the time." Orphy mimicked the sound blowing into her hand until the boy interrupted. "You know you have a spider in your hair?" he said. "Oh, yes. I nearly forgot. I should have introduced you sooner. My spider's name is Dorian. It is a special needlework tarantula."
"Won't he make your hair naughty?"
"Yes, very naughty. But that's okay by me." "Hey, you can speak," Orphy said with excitement. "Of course, I know all the language of those down here." "I do not live here. We are just visiting," Orphy replied, curiously looking out over his room. "But it has been awful vacation."
"Good. There are too many of you already."
"Really? I've only met one of me." "You know what I mean," he said, brushing it off. "People like you." "No one is like me. I am a goodbye." Orphy gave the torn piece of his body back to Fleck. "I'm very sorry about stepping on you," she replied sorrowfully. The grass boy tried putting the part back on like a shoe, but it would not stick. "If I only had some glue," she suggested, seeing his dilemma. It was then Dorian, the needlework tarantula, climbed down from Orphy's hair and offered his sticky spider webbing to clot the boy's wound with an application. It stuck the two pieces back together and lifted the poor boy's spirit. Orphy then spied a folded dollar bill that was currently being used as a blanket for his bed. "Where did you get your blanket?" she asked thoughtfully. "I have a lot in a pile outside," he answered. "They are Zenwick bucks. It's the currency down here." "Wow, my father told me of those. May I have one?" said Orphy, placing her finger back into the weeping vial. "Sure, but I don't see how it will help. It's completely wrong and not to scale." The grass boy suddenly recognized Orphy's enormous size before him and crouched back. Orphy could see Fleck was distraught. She reached into the tear jar with her finger to gently brush his scraggly hair. Unfortunately, upon doing so, she felt a slight paper cut, but continued to remain calm, as if nothing had happened. "It's been a horrible vacation. I can't wait to get home." Fleck made no reply, but dropped his head in sadness and cried. Tears of ink dripped down his face and puddled to the floor. "I wish I still had my town and people like me around," he shuddered. Orphy had a clever idea and took the bill from his bed, avoiding sticking her hand in the puddle of ink. "Do you have scissors?" she inquired. "I just ripped my pages out," Fleck said, trying to tear it, but the Zenwick bill was too thick for his tiny hands. "No, no, let me try." Orphy attempted to rip it and felt the weight of her mother's extra shears in her pocket. She took them out and showed Fleck how to make a paper doll chain matching his height. She took the remaining folded bill and folded it again into quarters accordion style. She did not have a pencil, but tried her best to gauge the character based on the boy with his arms extended beyond the edge of the folded sheet. She gave the cut bill to the twisted grass boy and told him to open it. When he did, they could see three identical flecks, linked hand in hand. The boy was full of excitement. "Oh, you have given it life!" "You'll have to find a pencil to draw their eyes, ears, and mouth, and they'll be just like you, except they won't be able to talk, see, or listen." Orphy clipped the paper flecks apart to free them from the bill. "Not true," he exclaimed. "I just need to assign each a preface. It's our way in Unabridged." With this, he took the quill pen and dipped it into his own puddle of tears, which Orphy figured the secretion must have been similar to blister beetle sweat. For after all, she brought to life her mother's flying trocar and her father's hat the same way. Orphy watched as he opened and dipped the quill into the bottle and began brushing the paper figures as he said the following: "Blot, chalk, foolscap, nib, felt, slip." It really must have been magic, for as he spoke and held each of their hands, the lines formed in the following order to give them each eyes, a mouth, hair, nose, ears, gender, and most importantly, a brain, to do what they could not otherwise do. Orphy could see their brains grow through the paper, translucent at first like the shell of a new bug, but in moments they hardened and could not be seen. "What they lack now will grow in time," said Fleck. What did all that mean? "Activate light in the body and illuminate." "Fascinating," exclaimed Orphy, astonished. "You can have these shears," she went on. "I can get another pair." "Thank you. These will come in handy. Do you mind taking a moment to name these three?" "By all means," she said, as he retreated to fold and cut out more. The three paper people looked on in anticipation. There was one who looked more like a woman, so she named her Bess, and one who appeared to be a man, she thought, Leroy, while the third was gender neutral, she called Lou. The boy stepped out from under the bed and examined her intensely. He could see she was quite different from the souls who wandered about, most of whom would never dream of wearing a tarantula on their heads. "My name is Fleck." He presented a sorrowful welcome by swooping the bangs out of Orphy's eyelashes, like turning the pages of a book. "What an impressive greeting," Orphy said. "People used to drop in from the sky all the time. I believe your land had a name for them." "Sinners?" No. Cinders," he continued anxiously. "They were called cinders because of how nicely they fell directly into the lake of fire. The nasty ones were punished for eternity in our old amusement park, Wits End. Sadly, ever since Lord Zenwick took over, he closed both, and the cinders no longer magically fall, but are safely redirected to become citizens of Nottholm." "Citizens? That sounds terrible. Who is Zenwick?" Fleck sat down, feeling distraught. "According to the etiquette book, Zenwick is the supreme ruler of Nottholm, and helped build the Baron's army to create harmony in the world above. It boasts he is a great wizard that found the secret to immortality. But I know the truth. I've seen what he has done to our grass people." Fleck paused. "What is a paper man if he has not been granted a conditional pardon? Is he not a document of his own proof?" "What do you mean? What he has done?" Fleck perused his room for the answer from the pages of Principles of Good Taste. The book talks about Zenwick meeting the Baron's son, but his name is not mentioned in the book. At first, the son was not business-minded like his father. He stopped momentarily from reading to look sternly at Orphy. "It is a rumor here, but I've heard he wanted to help people. He rushed to the far corner of the room to look at another ripped passage. The sun was on his father's mining expedition and struck a geyser of oil. He found the oil could be bottled as powerful elixir for anxiety to paralyze emotion. He ripped a piece off the ceiling and turned to Orphy and sat crisscrossed, continuing to read. The son went to his father with the elixir, but the Baron at first did not see its promise. Fleck stepped off his bed. This means he didn't see any financial reward. I have found the rest of the book to be lies. I heard the Baron disowned his son after that, and left him broke and destitute. It was only after the son began overusing the elixir on himself that Zenwick entered the picture and sort of took over. Did anyone stop him? Fleck paused, reflecting on the ripped-off piece of his body. He is a powerful wizard. We are so delicate, to say the least, the boy said to Orphy. Besides, I could never reach the tower where he lives. Every day his army gets bigger as more cinders sweep in. I suppose a few locals got away, but many were destroyed while others became his servants. I just hope I can bring the town of Abridge back. Is that the name of this place? Asked Orphy. No, it was Unabridged, returned Fleck, but I would settle for the people from Abridge. Orphy lied down to peer into the bottle more comfortably. Why was the library filled with only books on principles of good taste? His guidebook is the only book allowed here. He promises those who follow him will live again above ground, said Fleck softly, and then paused for a moment, as if in thought. Finally, he said, not to mention some of the cinders who are full of gas easily leak back up into your world through the pumps and invade the bodies of the paralyzed. Is that why the cinders no longer fall from the sky, so they can repopulate the earth above? Yes, and it's all his fault. Sounds like he really shook things up. Orphy turned to look at the sky. Fleck took a strip of binding and laid it down at the front of his door as he walked out. He wiped his feet and pointed. See those ghastly bright stars? It is only a theory, but I believe that people go up to those stars when they are turned. We did not have them before. I think the star is bright because we see your world through it. Orphy looked the boy in wonder. But why would the cinders go up? Gas can only go up in the world below. Speaking of this world, the tiny, thankful boy said, I have a lot of work cut out to do. I hope the next time I see you, our town will thrive once more. Abridge, yes, Abridge. A new start, he exclaimed. You will always be welcome. Orphy placed Dorian into her pocket and heard in the distance her parents calling while Fleck prepared to introduce a new set of paper friends to Bess, Leroy, and Lou. Blot, chalk, foolscap, nib, felt, slip.